Well, it's very nice to see you. And this lecture is designed for students mainly. And because I wanted to share my experience and my maybe lessons I learned from mistakes. So you can learn while you are in school and you can maybe avoid some of the mistakes in your professional career. I would like to begin with saying that I do not feel that comfortable to talk about myself. This is a kind of my journey from 1971 when I was a freshman in college to now, September 9, 2011, I was appointed as president of POSTEC. Because some of the points might seem boastful or proud and others. And that's the reason I feel a little bit uncomfortable about talking about myself. But yeah, please keep in mind. So, this is one page summary of myself. I was born in Jeju Island, Jeju City, in 1953. And I spent in Jeju until my middle school, and I went to Seoul for my high school, and I graduated from college with a BSE degree from Seoul National in 75, and I think we have 1975, the graduate here as well, the Professor Park. And I served 14 months in the military, not in the military, military kind of service. And then I got married and I went to the States in August 1976. So about 35 years ago. I got my master's from Wisconsin in medicine in 79. And then 82, I finished my PhD. And 2 weeks after finishing my PhD, I became professor in University of Washington in Seattle. I became assistant professor in September 1982. And as you know, I resigned from this the professor position from Washington at the end of August 2011. I became associate professor with tenure in 86. I became full professor at UW in 1990. I became professor and chair of bioengineering from EE to bioengineering in 1999. I became president of the IEEE EMBS. It's a professional society of engineering in medicine and biology society with about 8,500 members in 2005 and 6. And now, as you know, I became president in September 2011. So this is a one-page summary. Since I didn't bring my photo albums with me to Pohang, I don't have many pictures. So these are the pictures I kind of collected from my computer. This was me when I was three years old. 1956. This was me with my sister and two brothers around 1963. So we are skipping by about 10 years. And this was me when I was freshman in college. So this is after I entered Seoul National, and I was a freshman. And you can see me age 30 years in 3 seconds. This is using the technology we developed in our laboratory, research laboratory, in about 2001. So 30-year aging in 3 seconds, and just using two pictures, 1971 picture and 2001 picture. And as I kind of age, you can see me becoming less serious, like a smiling, but the hair is receding. So yeah, you can take it easy. Yeah, you become very serious while you are in college. You tend to, but in a lot of cases, you don't have to. So that's 71. That was 1981. I was finishing on my PhD in medicine, and my parents came and visited me, and this is my first daughter. So this was a graduate student apartment. And at that time, the rent was $120 per month. So with that, next year, following year, 1982, in September, I went to Seattle and I became assistant professor. I didn't know much. I think what I had was passion and enthusiasm. I didn't know anything about working with the industry. I didn't know about anything about patents. But somehow I became professor. If I have my resume, I submitted for the faculty position with, in my the home, and with that resume, I don't think I will have even have an interview these days. So this was my office in electrical engineering building, and you can see I was once young and handsome. And this was in following year, 1983, with my first daughter and second daughter. The Queen of England came to University of Washington in 1983, about April. So we had a faculty procession to receive the king, or to honor the king, a queen of England. So that was that event, and this was summer of 1983. And they are, as you can see, all grown up now. So this was about 10 years ago. Oops, my family. I don't know what happened. But my wife and two girls and the boy. Boy is now 24 years old. So this was me with three chips. These are not potato chips, but computer chips. These are the chip we made with the Texas Instrument. This is the chip we made with Hitachi and Equator Technology, which got commercialized. And you will see some of the results of using, not only developing these chips, but using these chips in medicine. So we were developing new technologies, and we were trying to apply those the technology we developed in medicine, which was a lot of fun, but a lot of frustration as well, which I will share with you. So how I decided to become the engineer and scientist? I think in my recollection is this one, U.S. nuclear submarine Nautilus. 1957, Nautilus was the first nuclear-powered submarine the United States made in 1955. And in summer of 1957, it went underneath the North Pole polar ice pack, about more than 220 kilometers submerged without surfacing. So that was, at that time, very sensational. So I remember that when I was very young. But what happened was my father borrowed a book about USS Nautilus from the library, and he gave it to me. He kind of asked me to take a look. And I took a look, and I couldn't read English, so I only kind of saw these pictures, and I was fascinated by this kind of thing. So I asked my father, what is the kind of key technology that made this possible? And he said, electronics engineering. And I said, okay, I want to be the professor in electronics engineering. That was about 1960. So I'm sure you have somebody like that, and you will have somebody like that in the future. And those are your mentors and advisors and others. They are very important to your professional life. Yeah, this was the thing that made me an engineer and maybe faculty member as well. So I said, okay, I want to be a professor. I want to go to the U.S. and get a doctorate and become a professor. So that was 1960. And as you can see, 1982, I became a professor. So in a sense, the dream was fulfilled in 22 years. But if you stayed still saying, okay, I became a professor in the U.S. in 1982, and you could, you know, one could take it easy. But then you have to modify your dream, upgrade your dream, and go after that dream. So this is a more detailed event. I became assistant professor at UW in Seattle in 82. I visited the first company, U.S. company, Physiocontrol, now Medtronic. And in the following about 22 years, I developed 16 new courses. So if I am asked right now to develop 16 new courses, I would say, that's impossible. But somehow, if I had an idea, I wanted to try out a new course. And I think out of 16, about 8 of them are staying as a permanent course. 8 we tried once or twice and we gave up. So developing a new course takes a lot of time and effort. But at that time, I wanted to try. I liked that challenge. And this is another significant event. My advisor, PhD advisor, asked me to co-chair the session. He was supposed to be the chair, only chair, but he said, why don't you co-chair the session with 6 papers with me? So I was listed as a co-chair. So your advisor's pool kind of guiding you and helping you is very important, not only during your graduate school or undergraduate school, but after you graduate as well. I got first NIH grant in 1984. At that time, that was a significant amount. And first master student graduated. And from 85 to 1990, we conducted a very large U.S. Army project on equipping all military hospitals with digital imaging. No x-rays, just digital viewing. And as a result, I spent a lot of time with doctors, a lot of time with the professors and doctors and U.S. Army people and others outside University of Washington. That was another kind of key experience I attained. And I learned how to work with people with a different background, different disciplines. And after 1992, I think Samsung Medical Center was one of the first hospitals deploying all digital hospital as far as the medical imaging is concerned in 1992 in Seoul. My first PhD student was graduated in May 1986. We worked on a series of the computer system we called University of Washington Graphics System Processor. We did a number one, and then we did up to number 12. And first invention was disclosed. At that time, again, I didn't know much about patenting. Invention was disclosed. First technology transfer was done. And again, it was not a big success. It was a kind of stepping stone. Yeah, first one, and then second one, third one. And then 88, I got the Early Career Achievement Award from the International Society. And then 88 to 1990, I chaired, as an associate professor at the time, I chaired the EE Faculty Search Committee, where we recruited about 7 new faculty members. And chairing a faculty search committee is not an easy task.
But I learned a lot, not only within the department, but working with the dean and provost office and the people at other institutions, because I have to call them up for the reference checking. And in 89, I had 4 fires in my research lab, and everything was destroyed. It was very disappointing or discouraging. But in looking back, without those fires, I don't think I could have succeeded in the 90s. Because what happened was, with all those fires wiping out everything, the dean's office and provost office equipped the rebuild the lab brand new and equipped the lab with a brand new the instrument. With all the instruments, I don't think we could have achieved the success we had in 1990 and others. So typically, like difficult times, after you go through them successfully, good times will come. And I became program chair of the large conference. This was about, at that time, 1,200 people conference. And I became program chair. And this was, again, it was not a paid job. You had to work like 50% for probably about 12 months without any payment. But yeah, volunteering for the society, professional society. And as a result, I got to know a lot of people, not only in U.S., but in Europe, Japan, and others. So the lesson here is that short term, it could be painful, because you have to not only teach, you have to do research, work with graduate students, but you have to spend time for the things maybe your department may not recognize. But in the long term, medium and long term, it was a big plus. Still, I was associate professor. And then, as a result of this, the SPIE Medical Imaging Conference recruited me, saying that, why don't you be the chair of the conference? And that was a medical imaging specific, and I became chair for 11 years, or 12 years. So during this time, I kind of became a leader in medical imaging field. They recognized me as a leader because a conference and symposium chair, you have to have a certain reputation, as well as you have to know a lot of what's going on in the field, so you can invite the invited speakers or plenary speakers and others. And again, I was a member and chair of the Transactions of Medical Imaging, which is the best technical journal of in medical imaging. And another thing I learned a lot was this. I became a member of the UW Provost Search Committee. Provost means there is no equivalent name in Korean. President in U.S. is all external relations. Internally, all the academic affairs, all the faculty, student affairs, and others are handled by provost. So it's a very important job. And I became a member of the UW Provost Search Committee. And from this committee experience, I understood what's going on across the university, from humanity and social sciences to the medicine and everything. And they have all different perspectives and how to run a research university. Very good research university. That was we spent a lot of time in recruiting a provost, but I learned a lot. So again, short term, you don't get much yet. But in the medium and long term, you gain tremendously. And we worked with Texas Instruments on one of the chips that we used in that morphing. That got commercialized after 6 years. So we had some successes. We had some failures as well. So the first patent was issued only in 1994. We filed a patent in 1988, first one. And it took 6 years to get the patent issued. And 1994, I got the first patent. So I became a professor in 1982. It took 12 years to get the first patent. But now I have probably more than 60, and I lost the count because the international patent, one patent, you get the patent issued in U.S., you get the patent issued in Japan and Europe and Korea and others. Then if you count them up, it becomes a lot. And in 1996, I became fellow of IEEE. You know, fellow is quite an honor in a professional society. And when I was a graduate student, first year graduate student in Wisconsin in 1976, I started reading the papers, IEEE papers. And there, in the author list, the name and after name, comma, and IEEE fellow. And if you are a student member, IEEE. So when I was reading those papers, I said, that was in 1976. Someday, I want to be IEEE fellow. That was 1976. I became IEEE fellow in 1996, 20 years later. So with effort and goal and necessary effort and persistence, you can do it. I didn't say this, but from my college days, from 71 to 74, the school was shut down more than half of the time. So we didn't learn much. But the professors gave us grade, passing grade. So we graduated, but we didn't have much good technical background. So I had to take courses from the junior level course when I went to Wisconsin. So you have much better, much solid technical background, I can assure you. So you should have confidence. You can compete anywhere in the world. That's the confidence you need. So, first ultrasound machine was commercialized in November 1996. That was a big moment. And then, second ultrasound was commercialized in 2003. Third ultrasound was commercialized in 2009. And we are waiting for fourth ultrasound machine and fifth ultrasound machines commercialized. And so, in the 80s, I made a lot of mistakes in research and commercialization. In the 90s, the more successes came, but few failures. In 2000, once you are experienced and you know what kind of the risks are there and you try to control the risk, I think a lot of the research projects can be success. I chaired the bioengineering chair search committee in 96, 97 as an electrical engineering professor. And I made recommendation to the deans, dean of medicine and dean of engineering, because bioengineering belonged to both. And two deans and provost didn't accept our recommendation and asked me to chair the chair bioengineering department. So I became, I refused twice. But they twisted my arm saying that you should become professor, chair of bioengineering, because University of Washington has been good to you. So now it's time for you to pay back. So I agreed to be the chair of bioengineering in February of 1998. And I had a big project with Canon and Singapore. This Singapore project was a $14 million project. And I got Hoan Prize in 2003. While one of the big the goal of bioengineering chair was have our own building. And we had that building groundbreaking in 2003. And I got the Distinguished Achievement Award from the University of Wisconsin, my alma mater. We had an opening of bioengineering building in 2006. So in 1998, I developed the plan. These are the things we need for bioengineering. In 2006, all those things got realized, all done. So I stepped down as chair of bioengineering in July of 2007. And third ultrasound machine was commercialized in 2009. I became distinguished foreign professor, spending about 15 to 20 days per year at POSTEC. That's why I am more familiar with POSTEC because I've been spending time at POSTEC since 2009 and 10 and then early part of 2011. And last year I received the EMBS Distinguished Service Award, and this year I got the William J. Morlock Award. And I have more than 450 research papers and taught more than 1,000 undergraduate students. And many undergraduate students did a research and capstone design project with me in my lab. And I supervised and graduated 141 graduate students in the last 29 years as a faculty member. I still have some. So these are the kind of significant events and turning points in my professional life. So there are some, the people who really gave me inspiration and motivation and help. One is Dr. Akira Ishimaru. He has been a professor in electrical engineering at the University of Washington for more than 50 years. He's about 84 years old. Still, he comes to his office every day and he works harder than average electrical engineering professor. He was on the search committee to recruit me. He didn't do much to me, but he is a giant in the field electromagnetics. Just being close to him and watch him work, his work ethics, that really motivated me because I wanted to be like him. So the role model, senior professors, even though they don't do much to junior professors or graduate students, can be a great role model. And the Ray Bowen, chemical engineer, but he was the dean of engineering at the time when I became assistant professor in 1982. He moved from Wisconsin to Washington to be the dean. And he was so kind to me. I was just a junior, just starting assistant professor. And he was the dean with the 200 faculty in the College of Engineering. So that kind of care and attention and encouragement can do really, really good things to young people. Lee Hartwell's picture is gone somehow. He got the Nobel Prize in 2001 in medicine and physiology. And he was in a different department, but just being able to work with him once in a while on cancer research. And how he works. And he's just a normal faculty member. Even after getting the Nobel Prize, he was just like, he didn't change. So being able to kind of talk to them as a fellow and colleagues, and that motivated me even further. And there are some other Nobel Prize laureates on campus, and being able to just see them going to their lab in their 70s and early in the morning, and then late in the evening, see them in the parking lot, that really motivated me. And not only me, but a lot of other people. So what's important is that kind of culture. Infrastructure, hardware is important, but after that, the software, culture is important. And Lee Huntsman, who was a bioengineering chair before me and who became provost and who became president of University of Washington, he was in bioengineering. I was in electrical engineering. He reached out to me and taught me on leadership, academic leadership. I don't know what he saw in me, but he helped me. He gave me opportunity. He encouraged me, why don't you chair this committee? Chair this committee means you're supposed to do 90% of the work. So along the way, I had numerous people like this. And the probably most significant person I got influenced was Dr. Bob Rushmore. He retired in 1985. So I had only 3 year overlap. He was in bioengineering, I was in electrical engineering. Again, different department, different building, far away. But he, about a month after my arrival in Seattle, he called me saying, I understand you are interested in bioengineering. And I said, yes, of course. Why don't you come to such a place and I will organize a meeting. And I went to the meeting and there were two doctors, two cardiologists, two people from industry, the Medtronics, and one other bioengineering faculty. He said, okay, here is a problem, clinical problem. Why don't you figure it out and develop a plan, tackle a plan, and don't come out until you are done. That was the kind of person, yeah, he was. He was a giant in the field. And that giant giving personal attention to lowly junior professor, that can change the professional the outlook and career, really. So, but let's see. Dr. Rushmore was a bioengineering, the founding bioengineering chair from 1967. Lee Huntsman was third bioengineering chair. I was fourth bioengineering chair. So the average chairship is about 10 years. And he designed the bioengineering building like this. Never built, fortunately, in 1968. He hired an architect and designed the building like this. His idea is research labs should have no windows. So they can focus on doing research. It was never built. But in some sense, this was unfortunate, and bioengineering was scattered around the building in 9 different locations on campus. 9 different locations. And when I became chair, we did the fundraising, and in 2006, we moved into this beautiful, all windows, bioengineering building. So sometimes something bad or seemingly bad turned out to be good. But how many years later? Many years later. Like 38 years later. And we raised about $100 million for the building. The state of Washington, we didn't get any money from the state of Washington, even though we are a state university. And at the building dedication ceremony, President Carter came. And I had lunch with him, and I gave him the lab tour. And he, at the press conference, he said, bioengineering's incredible potential for global healthcare. His passion is to help the people in the developing countries in healthcare and other areas. When I first went to U.S. in 76, he won the presidency in 1976 fall. From 77 to 2001, it was very difficult to watch U.S. Congress and U.S. president work. He, as the president, he was the most ineffective president. But as past president, in my opinion, he was the best past president. He's an engineer. He was a nuclear engineer. He was a U.S. Navy officer. He was trained under the Admiral Rickover, who was the father of the nuclear submarines in U.S. And so he, at age 83, he understood technology and potential applications very well. So this was at the opening celebration. Bill Gates came because he donated like $64 million for the building and about $10 million more for the endowed shares and others for bioengineering. And I was giving at that time, I think I looked younger. Yeah. And I was giving a lab tour to President Carter. Yeah. So in 1982, when I was assistant professor, I set up the research laboratory called Image Computing Systems Laboratory, with a clear mission to provide leadership and achieve excellence in research and education on image computing and programmable processors. And we even set out a strategy, how we are going to achieve the mission, to focus on systems-oriented R&D programs in image computing based on proper combination of technology push, which engineers love to do, and application pull approach. Application pull means you identify a problem and try to solve the problem. So, our approach was multi-pronged. Because typically in academia, we tend to focus on more engineering science or science. This is more on the science side. Computer architecture, processor architecture, and algorithms. This is what typical academics do. But because we wanted to solve real problem and systems oriented, we had to do applications and sometimes, when needed, implementation. So not only we did science, in our case, engineering science, not the pure science, but also application and implementation, optimal implementation. In a lot of cases, we did better, we achieved better efficiency than Intel and Texas Instruments engineers could. Because we understood architecture and algorithm, and we can map those things really efficiently. So we were working on a series of systems using new chips and commercializing several of those. This one was commercialized, this one was commercialized, this was a success, this was a Siemens ultrasound machine, and et cetera. So this was 1988. Probably even electrical engineers have not seen this kind of wire wrapping type thing in circuit board to test using the logic analyzer, and this is a fractal image being generated. So it was very, very painful, difficult. But we succeeded in a lot of this kind of project. And this is a block diagram of the third generation in 1988. And we implemented this in big board like this. And component cost was about $10,000. Very expensive, but very powerful. And in 1988, the idea came to me at the faculty club while we were having lunch with a Texas instrument engineer, saying that rather than using all discrete chips and many, many components in this kind of big board, why not put all this in one chip? And we drew the block diagram on a napkin. So that was the beginning of this multi-core chip. And these days, your Intel processors and others are mostly multi-core these days. But we developed a multi-core. We started to develop multi-core in 1988. And it became a commercial product in 1994. So this was a joint project between TI and University of Washington. And this was a traditional Intel processor. This was the DSP at that time. And we wanted to have an order of magnitude higher performance without increasing cost. That's why you saw me holding those chips. These are those chips. So if you have some, good understanding and experience in this area, you can innovate. You can think differently from others. And if you have enough experience, and particularly the lessons from failures, you can figure out where to go. So failures are not necessarily bad. Sometimes you learn best lessons from failure, and you can move forward. So this was inside the chip, one chip. And this was the board we developed. This is the chip we developed with Texas Instruments. And we developed this whole board, PC board, on our own. And we wrote software. and we commercialize this. And the applications, like a potato inspection, potato size, shape, color inspection. The state of Washington is a number two potato producing state in 50 states of the United States. Number one is Idaho. Idaho and then Washington. So the potato farmers send an airplane to Seattle, and small airplane. And I flew in that airplane to go to the potato farm and this kind of sorting area, and we worked with them and we installed our system. And we can sort about 60% of the potatoes. So these inspectors, they have to sort only 40%. 60% is already pre-sorted by machine. And I worked with Kirin beer company in Japan, and they deployed our technology to do the beer bottle inspection. And they showed me the factory, and beer bottles are going through the line at 60 bottles per second, very fast. And you have to kind of do the freeze frame type photography and then do the image analysis. What's wrong with this? Whether there is a foreign content or the beer, the volume is not properly filled, and etc. And I had a lot of experience in the hospital, particularly in the radiology department. And we were developing this new chip with Texas Instruments. And I went to the radiology ultrasound examination room, and I saw this. And these are all the boards inside the ultrasound machine. You can see many, many, many boards. And I asked them, what are they doing? And all the beamforming and the color Doppler and the spectral Doppler, beam mode, and et cetera. And I said, why don't we do it in a programmable way rather than hardwired way? So, because we were developing a very powerful new chip, and I knew I could do it. So I went to GE, Siemens, Philips, and they all told me that it will not work. They told me, no, it will not work. So I use this slide quite often to my students. The lesson here is, when experts tell you it will not work, they have done it, it will not work, 90% of the time they are right. 10% of the time, if you can prove them wrong, then you will be called a pioneer. That's how you can be called a pioneer or leader. You have to be different. You don't have to believe what experts tell you. If you have the confidence, just go with that confidence. Take the risk and be a leader. But to get to that point, it will take it will be lonely, painful, and difficult. So go against the flow. Don't follow what most people think and is the best way. Go against the flow. You have to have the courage and strength to go against the flow. So be a salmon. Salmon, to lay eggs, it has to swim across the against the current in the river. And it has to jump over the cliff. And bears are waiting at the top of the cliff to catch it. So you have to go through all that kind of danger. So, particularly in Korea, this is important. If we are talking about creativity and innovation and others, if all people are thinking same, there will be no innovation. You have to think differently. You have to always ask question, why? And we have to have the culture to accept diversity in opinions. So keep this in mind. If you want to be a kind of the pioneer and develop a new frontier and to be called a leader, you have to take the risk. So that was about 1990. 1996, Siemens commercialized this. And one of the good things about medical devices is it's very difficult to get in, but once you are in for a long time. We got the royalty checks for about 12 years from Siemens alone. It's like a cell phone. The royalty checks will probably stop in 12 months, but we got royalty checks for 12 years. So this is one application, and you can see this is the fetus. Expecting mother is here, and typically using ultrasound machine, you can see only the head or upper, over here, or lower abdomen area. But using our technology, we were able to do the whole picture like this. And this is about 1998, so about 13 years ago, we developed the software technology and the licensed it to Siemens. And this is, again, at the 1998 time, the fetus. You can see eyes and nose and others. And at the time, this was a state-of-the-art technology. Not now. I will show you the current technology. So, again, we did a licensing. And then we developed, based on all this experience, we had the opportunity to develop a new company, startup company. Hitachi approached us in September 1994, asking us, let's develop a new chip. And we worked together intensively for about 2 years, 1994 to 1996. We asked the question, is this a startup opportunity or licensing opportunity? Previously, all the technology we developed were licensed to existing company. But this one, we felt that this is a startup opportunity. And at that time, we want to be the next Intel. We wanted to beat Intel. What happened? Company was formed in spring 1996 in Seattle and San Jose. And we provided strong technical leadership and support. We got funding from Hitachi, Canon, Sony, and VCs. More than $120 million was raised, used in digital video, internet TV, set-top boxes, machine vision, and many others. It became very popular, but threatened by Intel and Texas Instruments. At the end, it got acquired by Pixelworks at $109 million in 2005. So, 9 years struggle. It was a good experience. Did we get any money? Yes, some, but not much. But experience was invaluable. Many of my former students worked here, and now they are working at Microsoft and other places. So don't be afraid of taking your technology all the way to a startup company, and after a few years, you will learn tremendously. If the company succeeds, you will benefit tremendously. If company fails, just you learned a lot. So don't be afraid. So this is that chip being used in set-top boxes. This is like your cable TV set-top boxes. And this is the Polycom, the video teleconferencing system, uses multiple chips. And again, this was me in 2003 with those TI chip and Hitachi chip and Equator chips. And this was in 2003 in November in Chicago at RSNA, the biggest medical imaging exhibit attended by about 60,000 people. We were introducing brand new ultrasound machine by Hitachi. And this machine from 2003 to until it got discontinued last year, 2010, they sold for about $800 million worth of machine. And Siemens sold probably about $1 billion worth of machines. So you can make a big difference even in licensing. And then this is our 3D, improved 3D technology in 2004. Now you can see real fetus, like a nose and eyes and smiling face. So this was the third ultrasound machine our research work led to. Hitachi commercialized this in 2009. All the computing inside is being done by one chip. I don't know whether anybody can name this chip. Anybody with a PlayStation 3? PlayStation 3 has this chip. This is IBM's cell chip. So one chip doing all the computing inside the ultrasound machine, including 3D. So our vision is, we are working on, still we have a group working in Seattle on the, okay, let's bring the ultrasound technology home. So technology is already kind of, was available. This is a company called Sonosight, and this is about $30,000 machine, but we have to lower the cost to $10,000. And my goal is maybe $499 ultrasound machine that we can buy from Amazon.com or maybe Costco as well. So we can use it at home for breast cancer detection and thyroid cancer detection and others. So our goal is, our vision is, okay, current users are radiology, cardiology, and OBGYN, and the next wave will be physician's office, your just regular doctor's office and visiting nurses, and ultimately patient or their family members. But it will take time, and it will take ease of use and lower cost, and et cetera, et cetera. But you have to have this kind of vision and drive it. You cannot drive it all by yourself. You have to have other groups and friends and supporters. Trying to do it all by yourself these days is very, very difficult to have any significant innovation. So this one, so a lot of people doubt that, why we need ultrasound machines at home? So let me share the real kind of case. Defibrillators. When you have a heart attack, you have to shock the heart to get it revived. And I don't know what's called in Korean, but it's called defibrillator. And we have a defibrillator in the apartment, faculty apartment, and across the campus these days. Okay, but defibrillators are, first defibrillator was looking like this. And this is a typical the operating room based or emergency room based defibrillator. It applies like a 3,000 to 4,000 volt. Very dangerous. Cardiologist in 1970 at University of Washington, he said or proposed defibrillators should go home. Why? That's the place where most heart attacks occur. And people said, you are crazy. How can this kind of expensive, difficult to use defibrillator, dangerous defibrillators can go home? But now you see it in the airplane, in the airport, even in post-tech, in different buildings, like this, right? It's very easy to use. It will tell you, it will give you audio feedback saying that make sure you apply this electrode, this and that, and stay back because you don't want to nearby when shock is applied. In 2002, US FDA approved the home use of defibrillator. So 32 years later. So most people said, no, the defibrillators cannot go home. But with innovation, with persistence, and others, it could happen. So I would like to see many post-tech students defying the common sense or commonly held consensus, challenge that, and make a difference. Finally, I would like to share my experience. Because Korea is now a developed country. There are many more people living in developing country or undeveloped country. Like maternal care in Africa. In some sense, this is very similar to in Korea in 1950s. The maternal care is provided by midwives, traditional birth attendants, and even family members. So what happens? Maternal mortality rate is very, very high. So let's take a look. Maternal mortality ratio is defined as a maternal death. Mothers dying due to childbirth, how many out of 100,000 live birth? In Sierra Leone, 2,000 mothers die. And during the lifetime, risk of maternal death is 1 in 16 in sub-Saharan African country, compared to 1 in 2,800. So there is a 100-to-1 discrepancy between developed country and developing country. And the reasons of death is mainly severe bleeding and obstructed labor, which detected early and treated early, you could avoid that kind of danger completely. So we deployed the small ultrasound machine and others in the local the midwives clinic in Africa in August 2008. Surprisingly, yeah, they don't have ultrasound machine. They didn't have ultrasound machine until we provided one, and our nursing student went there and trained on how to use ultrasound machine. But they had cell phones. Cell phones are everywhere, even in Africa. So we had a communication network available, so we captured the ultrasound machine, or the midwives captured the ultrasound machine using the communication network, uploaded the images to University of Washington, the servers, and the pediatricians, OBGYN doctors, and others volunteered their time to read the cases and provided feedback to midwives. So our doctor, OBGYN doctor, provide that kind of feedback. So this, this didn't have any, I don't think, commercial potential, but we wanted to see whether this kind of technology we developed in our lab could be used in helping people in the developing country. And I'd like to see more Korean young people paying attention to this kind of thing while they are in their 20s. So I encourage my students in Seattle, go, join Peace Corps and spend a year, or go to Africa or Indonesia and spend in India and spend a year volunteering. They come back as a different person, very motivated, mature person. So this is not the slide I generated new. This is a slide I've been using for about 16 years. I and my students, graduate students, developed this slide. What are the ideal attributes of graduate students? Ideal attribute. What that means is nobody has all these attributes. Ideal means nobody has all this. But ideal, we are the target. What I look for in graduate students is this first six: honesty and integrity. When graduate students come and see me and report saying that I have done this, 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 and it, this worked, this didn't work, I should be able to trust that report completely. So honesty and integrity is just absolutely important. And dedication and passion. Without dedication and passion, you will have a tough time in succeeding as a PhD student. And self-motivation. PhD is, in a sense, a training of how to handle discouragement and disappointment and failure. You will have a lot more of the failures and disappointment than successes. So how do you handle that? You have to self-motivate yourself out of that kind of discouragement. Hardworking, I don't have to say, hardworking. I think post-Techians are working very hard. Perseverance. You have to persevere through difficult time, challenging time, trials and tribulations. And as I said, good times will come if you successfully go through the challenging times. Innovativeness. Innovativeness is, innovating means you are doing things differently, better, new ways. And then independent thinking. PhD is a training for you to be an independent researcher. So independent thinking is part of the PhD training. Some students have independent thinking from the beginning. Some students don't have it, but toward the end, they get it. Communication skills. Communication skills are so important. Writing. Many students hate writing, but without good writing skills, you will not become a technical leader. The presentation skills, important. Good people skill in general, very, very important. Excel under pressure and ambiguity. You have a lot of pressure. But this is an important one, ambiguity. Typically, I, as an advisor, I give my students, okay, this is the goal. And I don't tell them, okay, take this route and take that route, because there is no highway from here to there. And students need to figure it out and making their own small decisions. And if they made mistake, come back to the original point and reset and do it. So ambiguity, you should be able to handle ambiguity. You are not the high school or freshman in college where everything is set. Okay, these are the input conditions, and then you kind of solve a problem. But the life is not like that. A lot of things are ambiguous. And you have to make assumptions. You have to make sure your assumptions are correct. And you have to check it, recheck it with time. Confidence. Constructive. Rather than criticizing, analyzing, because we are scientists and engineers, we can analyze and criticize things. Yeah, what's wrong with this all the time? But what I ask my graduate students is, go to the next step. Okay, analyze what's wrong with it. Come up with a viable solutions. I love those students. They can analyze the problem, and then they can say, okay, here is option one, option two, option three. That's constructive rather than destructive. Proactive, responsive, responsible, unselfish. That's not easy. Self-control, open to criticism, learn from mistakes and failures. Failures are not bad, not necessarily. Learn from them. Team player, these days you have to learn teamwork. How to work in a team. And interdisciplinary, you should be able to cross from maybe chemical engineering and material science or the electrical engineering and maybe life sciences and etc. Multitasking. Many students find this very, very difficult to do. But you know, okay, I will finish this and then I will put full 100% of my attention to the next. But the first task gets delayed, and you don't have time to attend the second task. It's better to divide your time. Okay, I want to devote first 4 hours on this, next 4 hours on this, and then come back to the first task, multitasking. And leadership and vision. This one, you may not have it now, but with experience and maybe more mentoring, you might have some of that, and then you can develop that further. Okay, so my students in 1995 developed a list for this. Ideal attribute for faculty members. And I've been using it for the last 16 years. Even I used this at post-tech probably several times. So students, graduate students, expect faculty members to have outstanding scholarship. So scholarship in Korean is very difficult, so I had to write it down. So very outstanding 학문적 역량. It's not 장학금. Okay, so because some students in Korea, they thought that, oh, faculty members should give us a lot of 장학금, and that's not it. This is outstanding, the 학문적 역량. And then they would like to see faculty members have personal and professional, not only professional integrity, but personal integrity in our own lives. Because you see us all the time. You see your advisor all the time. Excellent teacher. Teaching is very important in academia. Leadership. High energy. Vision. Striving for excellence. Rather than settling for mediocrity, always, even though excellence is always difficult, but even with that kind of difficulty, you always go for excellence. Communication skill, able to make difficult decisions, team building, patience. Patience is very difficult to come to faculty members. We tend to be impatient. My wife tells me all the time that when I was young, I was very impatient. Probably even now, I might be impatient. Sensitivity, this is an important one. Because with this, what the students are saying is, don't treat us same. Don't use the same ruler and measure us. Because each individual, each graduate student has different talents and weaknesses. Okay, so try to treat us as an individual rather than same whole group of students. And give us opportunity to maybe strengthen the strengths and kind of improve on our weaknesses. That's what they are saying in terms of sensitivity. Humility to faculty is very difficult, but I think it's absolutely essential for us to do research. Research starts with, to some extent, humility. Selflessness. That's tough, too. Ideal attribute for faculty. No faculty member has this all. I have never seen. I don't have this all. Confidence. Open-minded and open to criticism. That's very difficult to faculty. But we have to try. Self-motivated and tenacious. Multitasking. Not only now faculty as a multitasking, but multi-level. What this means is they are asking faculty members, go to the Microsoft board of directors, and be able to sell our lab or our department to the top level. At the same time, sit down with Microsoft engineers and software engineers and talk about algorithms and others. That kind of multi-level, that's what they want. Insightful, able to see big picture, planning, good recruiting, cheerleaders and supporters for former students. They want that. They want to see their advisor giving them cheering, and as I said, my advisor giving me opportunity to co-chair a session. That was, and looking at that now, co-chairing a session is nothing, but just starting young assistant professor, that kind of exposure is very important. Grantsmanship, industry relations, and press relations, very, very important. So, last two slides, my other advice. So, two slides. First, aim high. U.S. Marine Corps has that motto, aim high. You should aim high. And dream dreams and develop visions. Dream. You're young. have courage and confidence. As I said, you are the professional, technically you are much better equipped than I was 40 years ago or 36 years ago. Have courage and confidence to face challenges, current and future challenges. And your stage should be the world. Sky is the limit. Don't limit yourself to Korea. You should have confidence to go anywhere in the world. Korea, Europe, Japan, Hong Kong, Singapore, China. Wherever there are good opportunities for you to professionally grow, go. Don't hesitate. So the world is your stage rather than limiting the stage to Korea. Work hard with passion. Do not be satisfied with the status quo. Do not accept status quo. Always challenge the status quo. You have to change, you have to improve, you have to transform. Do not be afraid of being different from others. Otherwise, innovations will not come. And resist the peer pressure. All your friends are saying, okay, let's go here, let's do this. If you think it's not right, don't do it. You might be isolated or whatever, Korean, wangta, but don't be afraid. You are adult now. Okay, so resist the peer pressure. Because the peer pressure asks you to conform to certain, yeah, whatever the norm, but if you don't believe it's not right for you, don't do it. Do not compromise on your principle. Your honesty, integrity, professionalism, ethics, and others, do not compromise on those key principles. Don't compromise. Once you start compromising, your future leadership potential will be reduced. You should be able to stand on your principle and ask why and what often. Leaders, they ask why and what they should work on. Ask why. And yeah, your advisor might not like that in the beginning, but I think if you are respectful, I think it should be fine. Because that's where innovations and different approaches can come out. See things in a big picture. Because you are in the lab all the time and you see your world being your research and very narrow, myopic vision, but once in a while, come out from a well and be able to see a big blue sky. See a big picture. Be constructive rather than too critical, as I told you earlier. Complaining and destructive. So rather than being too critical and complaining a lot and destructive, be constructive. Willing to take good risk. Don't be afraid of taking risks. Because leaders, if you want to be a leader, you have to take the risk. To be a follower, the pathway has been already kind of made by the leader, so it's easier and safer. You don't have to take much risk, but to be a leader, you have to take risk. Accept failures and learn from them rather than being discouraged. This requires self-motivation to come out from that discouragement. Learn how to handle disappointment and motivate yourself. Ability to communicate well is critically important. Not only with your advisor, with your peers, and in writing, and as I said, writing, writing, writing. Because the best time for you to get writing skills, acquire writing skill, is when you write journal paper with your advisor. And when I submitted my first paper, it came back all red. And second time, still a lot of red. So it took me about 7 iterations for my first paper in 1978. And my record with my student was about 22 times. So that's the best way to learn. Technical writing courses in general, it's useful to some extent, but it doesn't really teach you the logic and the rationale and how you set up the introduction right and etc. Only your advisor and maybe the seniors in your lab can teach you. Writing, just absolutely important. Serve others and less fortunate people rather than being selfish. So live a life a little bit short-changed. What that means is that rather than working for short-term profits or short-term gains, aim for long-term gains and maybe collective gains. In Korean, I think 손에 보던 듯이 사는 게 is good. If you 챙긴다 그러나요? If you do that too much, your leadership potential will be reduced. You will get less respect and trust. So this is like rather than being selfish and aim for long-term gain rather than short-term profit. Be proactive rather than reactive. Persevere through a difficult time. Be very careful with success. I think when you are successful, that's the most dangerous time. Because you tend to become proud, pride will set in, and people will not recognize you much, even though you think you have been very successful. Because the peer recognition will not come that easily. It will come a lot of accumulated successes, you will get your peer recognition. So what happens is you achieve certain success, you expect recognition, you don't get it, then it leads to bitterness. And bitterness is like a cancer in your body. And that will limit your professional growth. So be very careful when you are successful. And when you succeed, distribute credit to others and aim higher. Rather than settling, being satisfied with what you got, aim higher. Earn trust and respect with honesty, integrity, and professionalism. Honesty, integrity, and professionalism. Develop a very good personal and professional relationship with your advisor. Not in a master-slave setting. Okay? In the beginning, maybe, but as you become more independent, develop your opinion, and others, it's more like a professional colleagues. And advisors, when you think you leave the lab, you said, oh, I'll say goodbye to my advisor, I will never see him or her again. That's not the case. A lot of cases, I write recommendation letters for my former students for a lot of different things, so awards and others. So try to maintain a very good personal and professional relationship with your advisor while you are in school and even after you graduate. Pride and greed kill. Pride and greed. If you are too greedy, bitterness limits your growth potential. Bitterness. So don't let bitterness grow in you. Ask how you'd be remembered when you pass away. I think a lot of young people, and maybe even middle-aged people, they aim for what? Money, power, and what was fame? Three? But some of you know it's not the goal of life. So you have to ask, what is the purpose of my life? Okay, ask how you'd be remembered when you pass away, when you die. Do the best you can, no matter what circumstances might be. Even though it's really, really discouraged, or it's looks impossible. Don't be, do your best and do not regret. Do your best and don't regret. Do not dwell in the past. Okay? Do not regret. It's very important. If you start regretting and, oh, I should have done that, done, there can be a million different scenarios. Find joy in what you do and be thankful. Because you have, I think 99% of you don't have to worry about yet, about your jobs or whether making a living and etc. You don't have to really worry about it. Learn from the past history. Learn from the past, but don't regret. Do your best in the present and create your own future based on your dreams and visions. So I hope my sharing kind of my 40-year journey and lessons I learned with you was useful, and I hope this the video can be made available on the website so you can ask your maybe friends to take a look at it. And I have many more slides, but thank you.